change gears now and talk about quality in thoracic surgery. Always appropriate to determine how we decide whether we're any good at what we do, and implied in this, how other people are going to determine whether they think we're any good or not. And this is a new era. What we'll talk about in the next few minutes is quite different from what we would have talked about even 10 years ago. So here's the approach to get a handle on this. I think it is important to get a feel for the SDS database and what it can do for us. I'll talk about the national performance measures that are used by CMS and other parties. Public reporting, it's upon us, and we need to know how to react to it and how to make ourselves look as good as possible. Practice guidelines, a few quick comments about practice guidelines, just because there's so many of them coming out, and I think that we need to recognize how they are supposed to be used, and that's not all of the way, not always the way they are used. Incentive programs, particularly the CMS incentive programs. I'll touch on three quality metrics that have started to gain popularity in recent years. And then lastly, make a comment about a new generation of risk models. So an update on the SDS database. Now, I think everybody in this room recognizes that this is a gold standard clinical registry, not only in the United States, but across the world, and that it forms a foundation for the way we assess quality in thoracic surgery. We can say with a straight face that it does represent a true national experience. This shows you the number of, the percent of cardiac surgery centers in each state that participate in the registry. Over 95% of cardiac surgery centers in the country participate in the SDS database, and over 95% of the patients that undergo cardiac surgery are entered into the SDS database. And this is the kind of information that that we get from the SDS registry. Mortality, morbidity, re-intervention rates, length of stay, all of these things and more are obtained in the SDS database and provided in the quarterly reports that are given out to the participants. This represents a national benchmark, true national benchmark, so that you can take the results that you see here and compare them against your risk-adjusted local results. And risk adjustment is available in the SDS database. We have around a dozen different risk models that will risk adjust your results so you get a true apples-to-apples comparison when you look at outcomes like I showed in the previous slide. One of the newest innovations that we have in the SDS database is a continuous link of the short-term clinical data in the SDS database with long-term administrative data from CMS. So this takes us into an entirely different realm. Now we're not only looking at our patient population that underwent, say, coronary bypass surgery in our hospital in the last year and seeing what kind of in-hospital mortality we had, we can look at that same group and see what kind of mortality we had in 1 year or 5 years or whatever. We can look at things like re-intervention rates. We can look at things like readmission rates, which CMS thinks is so important, and you're familiar with the fact that they have a penalty if your readmission rate falls below their risk-adjusted standard. And also you can look at cost to see how your costs compare against risk-adjusted costs across the country. So a ton of information that can now be gathered by this long-term link we have with CMS data. Well, we use all this to get national performance measures. And it's hard to believe it's been 16 years since this publication from the Institute of Medicine came out. And that was followed up 6 years later with this publication from the same organization. The key to this is shown in the quote from that publication. The only way to know whether the quality of care is improving is if we can put a number on it, if we can objectively measure it. And that's what we're all about, particularly in these national initiatives. The way we go about that is with performance measures. The three different types of performance measures are shown here. Outcome was my risk-adjusted operative mortality. Process was the patient discharged on aspirin. Structural is the staffing ratio in the intensive care unit adequate. And these are the measures that are used across the country. Well, if that's what's going to be used, we have to have a standardized way of determining what they look like. And we have that through two different organizations. Typically, what you'll have is a professional organization deciding, okay, it looks like this concept is valid for a way to measure quality in our specialty. And that concept then is taken to this organization, PCPI, and over a process that unfortunately takes up to a year, that is honed into a performance measure, a performance measure that, has been fully developed. You then take that fully developed measure to the National Quality Forum, and here it obtains national endorsement. Once again, a very laborious, tedious gauntlet of fire that these measures are subjected to. And yeah, it's expensive, as well as being time-consuming and tedious. But the advantage that you get at the end is that you've got a bulletproof measure. No one can challenge this measure once it's gone through this this process. Turns out that STS has more of these nationally endorsed performance measures than any other professional organization in the country. And while it's valuable to look at... particularly keen on this. We have composite measures for coronary bypass surgery, for aortic valve surgery. As you see in these two recent publications, we now have them for mitral valve surgery and for lobectomy as well. And these composite measures are used in a way that allows your individual scores in a weighted fashion to be brought together in this composite group so that you get one score for the composite. In STS, it's a 1, 2, or 3-star rating that you may be familiar with. I throw this slide in there just to let you know that it's not a simple matter of attaching a simple weight on each one of the performance measures and totaling it up. This is one page out of a 30-page document that describes the statistical approach, and I throw this in there to show you that it's not for the faint of heart. Here's a real game changer. What I've mentioned up to this point has been applied to the hospital level. And now we're moving into taking these same kind of performance measures and composites and looking at the individual surgeon. So this is a true game changer. You can imagine the amount of resistance that was encountered over this. The position of STS has been, well, you know, this is gonna happen. So either we do it, and we do it in a way that's as fair and meaningful as possible, or we're going to let some idiot from CMS do it and cram it down our throats. So the position of STS was, yeah, let's go ahead and do it. But what does that mean for the individual surgeon? That means you're going to be looking at curves like this in the future. You're going to have a score attached to, Gary, the way you treated your last 100 coronary bypass patients. And if your score is 97, you're in pretty good shape. If it's 87, what are you going to do with that? If it's 77, what are you going to do with that? So we don't really know what we're going to do with this information yet, but it's gratifying to know that at least surgeons have come together to develop the techniques that are used to do this. So it's as fair and meaningful as it possibly can. And that brings us to public reporting. We were very resistant to this 10 years ago. Now, as this quote from the American College of Surgeons bulletin points out, it's just upon us right now. And we have it as an embedded part of the current healthcare culture. And you see in the internet, it's all over the place out there. Whether it's something from CMS, whether it's healthgrades.com, there are a bunch of them out there. The debate rages still on public reporting. The advocates of public reporting would say, this is why we need to have it done. And those who take another approach to public reporting say, well, maybe not. And it's worth talking just for a second about these two reasons that maybe public reporting is not such a good idea. Unintended consequences. Risk aversion is out there. It's alive and well. It was shown very clearly in the New York State registry that is not voluntary. Paradoxic patient choices can occur. Good documentation of this as well. Improperly used publicly reported information can actually lead patients to the wrong hospital rather than the best hospital. Inappropriate accountability. Who is really responsible for these performance measures and making sure there's good adherence to them? It's not terribly so much of a problem in surgery, but in medicine, just imagine that. You've got these patients with multiple referral doctors and they have an adverse event so that you're not in conformance with the performance measure. Where's the accountability for that? Who's responsible for that? and questionable value. A few patients read the reports, even few understand them. There's a little change in the patient choices when these public reporting schemes come out. And very importantly, there's not a consistent improvement in quality. The idea is, if your results, you know, are going to end up in the paper, you're going to do a better job than what you would do otherwise. Well, number one, everybody I know bristles at that concept, but that's the thought behind it. And that's not been seen at all. Granted, there have been some instances where exactly that has been seen, but more often than not, it's just all over the place. You can't say that public reporting will improve your quality. So, summary on this, those that advocate public reporting would say this. Those that would not advocate it would say that. One thing is clear, though. The strategy that we need to have for public reporting cannot be this brick wall that we tried to throw up 10 years ago. I mean, that's just not going to work. Again, this is embedded in our culture of quality, and so we're going to have to figure out the way to make it as fair and meaningful as we possibly can. And one way to go about that is to determine what principles ought to be applied when we do publicly report. And virtually all of the professional societies have stepped up to the plate to offer their opinion on what these principles should be. ACC, as you see here, STS has a set of principles, as does the American College of Surgeons. And these are the common denominators that all of these organizations have proposed as the principles that any public reporting system should have. Most, I will have to say, at least in my experience, adhere to these, or at least try to, certainly not all, though. Worth mentioning that STS has partnered with Consumer Reports to develop a public reporting program. The value of going with Consumer Reports for this is that it attracts many more people that are going to view the reports as compared to if we did it ourselves. But we have done it ourselves, too. And this voluntary public reporting program from STS now is just approaching over 50% participation, totally voluntary. And we're approaching 75%, we hope, just in the next couple of years, and it's doubtful we'll ever get to 100%, but the rate is increasing. Practice guidelines. We see more and more of these, and it's important to emphasize that what we see in a practice guideline is just an accumulation of evidence and the rationale for taking one acceptable or a series of acceptable management approaches. Not a cookbook, not a benchmark. It does not dictate management, nor does it establish the standard for patient management. And I find a lot of physicians that don't recognize that. You can be assured that there are a lot of attorneys that recognize, would try to say that these are the purposes of a practice guideline. Not the case. Again, it just saves us the trouble of running down the evidence so that we can see a proper way to manage patients. Not the only way, but a proper way. Incentive programs. Pay for performance, rolled out with this Federal Registry report back in 2006. And since then, it has continued to grow under a variety of different names. You're probably familiar with MACRA right now. The pay-for-performance element associated with MACRA is called MIPS, the Merit-Based Incentive Payment System. It's worth recognizing that there are going to be some elements to this that are that constitute a composite. You see the four elements right here. The quality element, straightforward. They're going to look at how well you comply with the performance measures, the kind of thing that we talked about just a second ago. Resource use refers to a comparison of your cost, the cost of treating your group of patients compared to risk-adjusted cost for similar patients across the country. Clinical practice improvement activities. If you know what that means, maybe you could tell me about it after the meeting. Examples include care coordination, shared decision making, safety checklists, expanding practice access. I don't know what that means. Apparently CMS does, so. And the advancing care information, this is just a new name for the meaningful use. So all of these are going to come together in a composite score that you will get that will make a major determination on your reimbursement. Here's a timeline that is being proposed for that. By 2019, it's supposed to be rolled out. Once again, fasten your seatbelts. But it is a quality payment program that is clinician-driven and patient-centered. It says so right here by CMS, so you know that has to be right. Okay, three quality metrics that you're going to be hearing more and more about in the future. Patient-reported outcomes. This is virtually any patient, this is any outcome that the patient themselves has documented through a variety of different mechanisms. And typically what you're talking about is how well are you feeling, how well are you able to get around, what's your general sense of well-being. And there are very specific questionnaires that are instruments to collect this kind of information. You're probably already familiar with the SF-36. PROMIS has a variety of different instruments that are used for several different domains that can be looked at. But these patient-reported outcomes are coming to be an important element of quality. What the patient thinks about their care, of course, is important. Frailty, really key. It helps us quantitate clinical judgment, subjective kind of eyeball tests that we've had in the past. This allows us to put a number on it. The real definition is reduced physiologic reserve. I'm not sure that really applies, but just for your information, that's the definition that is proposed in the literature. We need to be aware of this and pay more attention to it because it really is a significant risk factor in surgical patients, especially cardiac surgery patients. A variety of different ways that we can measure this, grip strength, this Edmonton scale, the 5-meter walk test slash gait speed are well accepted measures of frailty. Something called the 6-minute walk test and the KCCQ traditionally measures of congestive heart failure, but they're also regarded as a valid way to get some handle on frailty as well. And all of these you'll recognize as being some surrogates for quality of life. The STS, for those of you that participate in the STS database, encourage your surgeons to get this 5-meter walk test, to get the gait test. It's critically important. It's collected by STS now. The rates are pretty good for data collection right now. And one of the reasons that it's important is shown right here. Gait speed is very much an indicator of your operative mortality. What you see on the y-axis is a hazard ratio. Not an absolute number, but a hazard ratio. So at your lowest gait speeds, the operative mortality for adult cardiac surgery is 4 times what it would be for normal gait speed. So clearly, very important. We need to be collecting this, and it will be analyzed in the future. Failure to rescue refers to the mortality rate of patients having experienced a given a complication or a set of complications. Being used a lot in the literature these days, accordingly, STS developed their own FTR measure based on the population that you see here. This shows the information that we found from that. Bottom line is there was a 10.5% FTR for coronary bypass surgery. And let me illustrate with the next slide one of the reasons we think it's important to look at FTR. This is a totally unanticipated result. We took all of these 1,100 centers that we used in developing the FTR measure, determined the complication rate for each one of those centers, and then divided them into 3 different terciles. And to our surprise, we found that the group that had the lowest complications had the worst FTR. What you see is an FTR-ODE ratio. Anything greater than 1 is bad. That means your observed ratio was worse than what was expected. And we saw that in the lowest complication rate. Conversely, in the group that had the highest rate of complications, we see the most favorable FTR. Now, exactly why would that be? I think this illustrates the fact that with FTR, we're shining a light on something in the quality spectrum that we've not seen before. We're going to drill down on this and come up with some ways to offer explanations. You know, maybe it's the more complications that you have, the better you are at treating them, so your FTR is going to be better. Who knows? But again, it shows the value of looking at quality in a relatively unusual way. And lastly, a new generation of risk models. The traditional way we look at risk models is to have these risk factors that we're all so familiar with go into a risk model, and you predict operative mortality, you predict complications, you predict risk. Well, a new generation of model is going to augment those risk factors by looking at things like frailty and patient-reported outcomes, as we've just mentioned. Very importantly, the outcome that can be predicted now with those measures is benefit, not risk, but benefit. So it'll look something like this. You'll choose whatever metric you're going to use. Gait speed is probably going to be what's used by the STS. You get that value pre-op, you get that value post-op, and then the difference is going to be a measure of the benefit that's experienced by the patient. So what do we do with it? Now we've got a number that we can put on benefit, and if we've got a number to it, then we can model it and we can predict it. And when you think about it, that's the first thing we ought to do. Rather than predict the risk, you want to predict the benefit. Because you predict the benefit if it turns out the patient is not likely to benefit from the procedure, then you should stop right there. What difference does it make whether you can do it safely or not? So you begin by predicting the benefit. Then you predict the risk, and then you can get a proper way to objectively weigh this risk versus benefit ratio in a way that we've never been able to do before. So this is truly a new generation of risk models, and it's going to make a difference in the way we evaluate patients for surgery. So very much a journey. Once again, what we talked about 10 years ago is not what we talked about today, and what we talk about 10 years from now is not going to be what we talked about today. Very much a journey, and you've heard me say it at least a couple of times today. Fasten your seatbelts. Okay, that concludes my presentation. We're going to have a panel discussion.